Hello and welcome to my Magnavox Museum collection. This is part two of the Magnavox Mid-Century Modern Imperial. Classic Magnavox that I'm going to have for sale for a limited time on eBay. This second video will demonstrate the Bluetooth and tape recorder functions and radio. Here we go. As the first video showed you, when you turn the unit on, it's all internally wired into Bluetooth and also to a nice accent LED backlamp. So the Bluetooth comes on automatically. You go to your your Bluetooth music source, which is like your phone, play as you normally would, and you hear nothing. There we go. So there you have it, beautifully modernized with a beautifully integrated Bluetooth feature. And of course, you may enjoy listening to radio. Now, your reception is going to depend on how close the stations are. I'm underground here or below grade level in the museum. So even so, the reception is amazingly good on the built-in antenna that Magnavox provides. So we're going to take a look at that for a minute and listen to the radio. Now, there is a remote control. Keep in mind that remote control compared to today was in its infancy back in 1967. And Magnavox had a clever unit called the Magnavox Phantom, which would allow you to have remote control functioning and never worry about batteries. There are no batteries. There's a very clever bellows, and when you push the button, it provides air pressure through a precision machined brass whistle at a frequency that you can't hear, like a dog whistle. That frequency is picked up by a microphone internal to the set behind the grill, and then it registers the commands through a control chassis. Really pretty elaborate. And I don't guarantee it's always going to work. They were a little problematic back then. And I probably got about 25 of these remotes, and I picked what I would call the magic remote that seems to have pretty good results with this set. There is some fine-tuning you can do between the frequency of the hand unit and the base unit, but that's very delicate, and it's beyond the scope of this video, and I really don't recommend it to the neophyte. But this one doesn't need that. This is a remote that this set likes pretty well. So let's see what happens. And you'll learn a way to push the buttons, too. You kind of keep your finger on it firmly, and you push down towards station select as you press it down, and you develop the most air pressure, and it seems to have the best results. So let's see if it's in the mood to change some stations.
Shower, and I love my steam shower, especially in the winter.
It's in a good mood. You can also adjust the volume, and it's done in steps. A little lower, a little lower, off, then back on. So, to remind you, the steps are, it'll go a little lower and a little lower to soft, then it will turn off. When you turn it back on, it'll be at full volume. It's important that you be sure that it's in the full volume position when you operate the set tone controls and such, because you only get full range sound quality when it's at the highest volume level. The other two muted positions are really designed for conversation or if the phone rings, okay? Full fidelity listening is at the loudest pass-through volume. And now it's going to be story time. This is one of my favorite Magnavox stories because it's kind of a nice independent endorsement, you might say. I've been fascinated with hi-fi since I was a kid back in the 60s. And Magnavox was my first hi-fi true love, and I worked for them for 30 years, so they're always going to be my favorite. But I was fascinated with some other hi-fi equipment at the time, and then later in life, you often go back and try and collect what you wanted as a kid that you couldn't possibly afford. One of them was Revox, because I was fascinated with tape equipment, and Revox had a world-class tape recorder called the A77. They had many other models to follow that, and they had a few before, but the A77 is probably the one they sold the most volume with, and it has worldwide notoriety. It was very expensive at the time, and they also made very limited production. They made matching amplifier and tuner. And it's really a beautiful thing to see these all matching and displayed together. As a matter of fact, the camera angle usually isn't wide enough to capture it. So what I did, just to give you an idea, it's not the best quality, but here is an ad, or actually a piece of literature, that shows all three together, see? So I always wanted that. Now, the tape decks are easy to get, and this will relate to Magnavox in just a moment. The tape decks are easy to get, but these matching flanking units, the tuner and the amp, are very difficult. They cost almost as much, and I think one of them cost more. I think the tuner cost more than the tape deck. They're extremely expensive. I think, don't quote me, but I think the last time I checked, all these together would be about 12 grand in today's money. And by the way, you don't have any speakers yet, so you ain't listening to nothing. So, obviously, as a kid in the 60s, I'm not going to have that. So, I did manage to get the deck pretty easily, and after a lot of searching, I found a fella, he happened to be in the Atlanta area, who had the amplifier. And he was a very high-end hi-fi enthusiast, and I met him, and it was a Craigslist thing. As a matter of fact, we met at the police station, which is probably a good idea on Craigslist. So, I met him there. And I paid him for that amplifier, and we got to talking, and, you know, got to liking each other, and we weren't afraid of each other, so I invited him to come over and look at my museum, and I had mentioned Magnavox. He was kind of puzzled, because I don't think he had really heard much about Magnavox other than televisions, and wondered why I was so enthusiastic about Magnavox audio when he's listening to Revox. Or actually, he used that amp in conjunction with a collection of his that included a lot of Macintosh equipment, okay? So primarily, his everyday main high-end system was Macintosh, which is like the Rolls-Royce and hi-fi. So he comes over, and I played a tape for him, and I'll tell you what I played for him. I played this. This is from The Graduate. And the selection on here is called The Folks. And I'll tell you why it's really fun to play things that were new when this set was new. It's not just nostalgia. There's a practical hi-fi listening experience angle to it also. You see, the engineers that made this set, this Magnavox, the engineers that engineered this, used the recordings of their day to test, evaluate, and decide what the best final design releases would be. And I wish I could find the issue, but Stereophile had an issue where they admitted that there is a lot of equipment out there that tests great on the test bench. You can test it with an oscilloscope, you can test it from you know, 20,000 cycles to 20,000 and beyond, and everything looks great on paper, and then you listen, it's not that hot. And sometimes the opposite happens. It doesn't look particularly impressive on paper, but when you play it, it's fabulous. And that brings me to the point of Magnavox's success. It was really Frank Fryman's idea from the very beginning to have an integrated design approach. He did not believe in trying to get a cartridge, phono cartridge, to go the widest possible frequency range and the speakers to go the widest possible frequency range and all of this stuff. Not that he didn't appreciate frequency range, he certainly did, but he knew that there was much more to it than just designing on paper and plugging everything in and then just saying that's the best we can do. He called it integrated design and even wrote an article once that was advertised nationally explaining why they did this. It's so that every component would complement the next. He was interested in the totality of what the sound was. Now, that's very subjective. But frankly, you'll find that even the highest-end equipment, and particularly the highest-end equipment, is evaluated on a very subjective basis. Very rarely do you see reports that talk about any measured frequency response or noise or anything else. It's the listening experience. This is all personal taste, of course, but here's the punchline. I played this selection, which I'm going to play for you in a moment. I played it for the gentleman with the Macintosh equipment who sold me the Revox amp. And he was very quiet. He was so quiet, I didn't know what he thought. And when he spoke, he said, I honestly could not tell you that if I played that selection on my set at home, which was Macintosh equipment, that it would sound any better. And that is the beauty of these systems, is you get the right recordings, and not all recordings are done as carefully as others, and some are going to be great and some not so hot, although most of the time I find myself very impressed, particularly with anything recorded during the time that the set was made. But as you heard with modern day jazz smooth jazz through the Bluetooth, that sounded great. So anyway, without further ado, I'm going to play the folks from The Graduate and see what you think. This is what the Macintosh owner said wouldn't sound any better in his own home. And you know what? I forgot to demonstrate one of the great features of this set. When you're ready for the tape deck, you've got to switch your switcher. So, actually, turned into a good demonstration. Number one is for the Bluetooth. Number two, right next to the tape deck, is for the tape deck. Be nice if I followed my own directions. Okay, here we go. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed that as much as the Macintosh owner did, and I look forward to visiting you again on the third part three demo, which will concern itself with recording on the tape deck and playing the changer. See you then. Thanks for tuning in.